Hi, good day. Happy New Week to you. My name is George Asian. Very often, we undermine the power, the import, the efficacy of questions in a conversation, in communication, in persuasion. Questions, to ask the right question will determine the direction of a sale. The one who knows how to ask the right question will determine the direction of the influence. And questions are quite powerful. So today, how to be a lot more persuasive. You are either the persuader or the persuaded. You are either the influencer or the influenced. In just skimming cut of life, you cannot be in the middle ground. You have to find a way to be at the other end where you are influencing people. So today, we'll continue our conversation along the line. If you joined us in WhatsApp yesterday, we said a dangerous territory. And let me begin by telling you this. You need to master persuasion. I said to you in that WhatsApp class that persuasion and negotiation are two very important communication skills. So if you're writing down anything, write down those two words, persuasion and negotiation. The ability to persuade in life. And the ability to make progress in life. Let's now talk today about questions. One of the things that very often happens when we engage in interactions and conversations with people is that we get into trance. What's a trance? A trance is a kind of daydream, you know, where your imaginative faculty is inspired, triggered, so that you begin to see certain things. For example, if I start talking about my boarding school experience, you know, most of you who went to, I'm sure right now, you are almost going into trance. If I start talking about my boarding school experience, or the experiences I had with a senior in the boarding school or in the school, or the experiences I had when I was a senior, you know, in school, or senior prefect, or the challenges I had in school, the hunger, or if I start talking about the hostel experience I had at the university, you know, in the boys' hostel, the challenges that we faced, the moment I start going descriptive and graphical, if I start telling a story about it, you get into trance, especially if you had a similar experience. The very moment I start talking about my own mother, I don't have a mother right now, but if I start talking about the love, the care, the concern that she had for me, you, if you don't have a mother, you start remembering her. Or even if you have a mother and your mother is not around you, you start thinking about her. So certain words, certain hypnotic words put us into trance. Certain direction of conversation puts us into trance. And the thing about trance is that when we get into trance, we lose guard. In other words, people who are in conversation with us have access to our souls, or have access to our subconscious. So whenever anybody tells you a story, he's actually getting it into trance so that he can have access into your subconscious. And when a person has access into your subconscious, he has access into you. So storytelling puts us into trance. All right? This is very vital. When a fraudster wants to get money from you, one of the many things he starts to do is that he starts to tell a story. How that he came back from someplace and then he has his goods here or there and he's looking for how to, you know, dispose of them, and he feels that you're the kind of person that he can trust and work with. The very moment he starts engaging in a conversation of that nature, he's trying to put you into trance so that, you know, your guard, because, you know, our conscious mind is where our logic and our reasons are, so that your conscious mind can collapse and you can have access. He can send suggestions, he can send thoughts, he can send ideas to you. So be very careful about storytellers. Be very careful about people who tell you stories. So now, having said that, that stories put us into trance and give us access to, and give people access to our souls, how do we counter people that tell us stories? Your pastor will tell you stories, all right? Parables and stories and testimonials to put you into trance of hope. So is all trance bad? No. All trance isn't bad. Or all trances aren't bad. There are certain times you need to be in such state, the picture of your future has to be clear for you to see so that it can drive you forward. There was a relationship between your vision, what you see in your mind, and your emotions. There's a relationship between your vision and your motivation. There's a relationship between your vision and what inspires you. So the very moment you start seeing clearly, you know, or you start getting into that kind of trance, you will be driven towards whatever it is you're pursuing. Am I making any sense? I'm sure I am. So think about it. Words, like especially stories, will get people to start seeing things. One of the best ways to persuade your children, if you have difficult children, or if you have children who you want to instill values and instill philosophies into them, is to learn to tell stories. Tell them stories. And in those stories, make sure that you embed, you know, values and philosophies that you want. So that even though they are enjoying the story, the element of the story, you are assessing their story. The beautiful thing about storytelling is that stories, you know, they don't only inspire our imagination, they also touch our emotions. So storytelling is powerful, and it can be used for good, and it can also be used for evil. So questions are those things you use to counter storytelling. Questions are the direct opposite of storytelling. So let me give you an example. If you are having a conversation with a fraudster and you suspect, if you have the sensory acuity to know that this person is a fraudster, he's trying to, you know, swindle me of my money. What do you do in that kind of situation? He starts telling stories. You quickly know that he's trying to put you into trance. What you should basically do at that point is to make sure that you start asking questions. You start asking a lot of questions. The more questions you ask the person, the more you break out of trance. So questions break out of trance. Before we go into specifics on how to use questions and what kind of questions are available, let me say these very important points. Number one, the one who asks questions controls the conversation. If you are in a sales meeting and you're supposed to get that prospect or that buyer to buy from you, make sure you are the one controlling the questions. Because the one who controls the questions, who asks the most questions, determines the sales direction. Before you go for that meeting, make sure that you are put together well-scripted and crafted questions that you ask. So when you have engaged in a conversation with that person, the person asks the questions, you know, asks you a question about the product or the service or the features or the benefits. All you simply do is you answer and then you throw back the question to that person. Now in sales, questions determine the direction of influence. I already said that. Poor salespeople want to monopolize. They literally want to monopolize the question. They want to keep asking, they keep talking and talking and talking, and they keep pitching. And they feel that because they are pitching or speaking a lot, the prospect will respond to them. But successful salespeople, what they do is that they find a way to monopolize the accent. They become a lot more persuasive when they monopolize the accent. So it's great to be with you today, and I'm sure that you'll start asking more questions, because this is what research was done in 1970 by Harvard University. And guess what they found? They found out that a lot of people don't ask questions, enough questions. You know, whilst for some people, questions come easily because they are naturally inquisitive, but a vast majority of people don't ask questions and inquire in an optimal way. And because they don't ask questions, they don't live optimal lives. Now, they don't ask themselves questions, and they don't find a way to ask, you know, other people questions, so they don't have enriching experiences. Now, let me tell you what this means. The quality of your life is dependent on the questions that you ask yourself. The quality of your life is dependent on the questions that you ask yourself. And so you are a question away from your next progress. You are an information, a question away from your next level of success. The quality of your life is dependent largely on the questions you ask yourself. So according to Harvard University, people don't ask themselves and don't ask people enough questions. And here's what Gail Carnegie is the author of various books. One of the books he put together is Public Speaking. Fantastic book. I encourage you to get it. If you can get it, fine. Masterpiece. Great book written so many years ago, but still very valuable today. And there's another book he wrote together, and I also encourage you to get it. That book is titled How to Win Friends and Influence Others. I read a book over 20 years ago, 21 years ago, and it really turned my life around. It helped me see life in a new dimension. Now, here's what he once wrote about influence and about questions. He says that when you don't ask, you don't get. You need to start learning to ask. You need to start learning to ask. The beautiful about questions is that questions will spur learning and exchange of ideas. So if I meet anybody, the first thing I want to do is engage in questionings so that, I mean, even though it's subtly, so that I can learn from the person and I can get ideas. I believe that every circumstance that we face and every person that we meet is, every circumstance that we face is a lesson, and every person that we meet is a teacher. So it doesn't matter what happens to me. The one singular question I ask is, what does this mean? How can I benefit from it? Those are reframed questions, empowering questions that helps me extract lessons from the circumstance, irrespective of what it is, whether it is negative or it is positive. Every person I meet, even if it's a bad teacher, even if it's a smart person, can give me information by asking my question, why am I in this relationship with this person? Why is this person my acquaintance? What can I benefit from him? Those kind of questions will enable me to get value from that relationship. For those of you who have been following me, I often say to you that every single person you have has an emotional agenda. What is an emotional agenda? An emotional agenda is what a person will do in spite and despite the risk. An emotional agenda is a person's hidden desire. An emotional agenda is a person's interest, a person's fascination, a person's ambition. It's there in his subconscious. And for you to be able to successfully persuade people or persuade a person, you must have access to his emotional agenda. And I taught you that there are four ways to have access to people's emotional agenda, or what we call people's emu button or hot button. The first way is to look at the eyes. We've done extensive analysis of that. I'm going to still show you, if you join our master classes, if you join our school, how to work with the eyes, how to determine strategy with the eyes, people's emotional agendas with the eyes, and so on. And then beyond that, you know, you also look at the facial gestures and the body language, because our physiology has a language. And then you can start studying body language and decoding, literally, people's emotional agenda. That's how to influence it. And we also said that by listening to people's words, not just the content of their words, but the tonality of the word, because there is a message in the tone. There is as much eloquence in the tone of a person than in the direct words. As a matter of fact, 38% of the impact and the influence anybody has on you or you have on anybody is hidden in the tonality or the vocal variety or the prosody of a person, the inflection of a person. So I don't just listen to the words of a person, I'm also listening carefully to the tone, not just what he's saying, but how he is saying it. All right, so by asking questions, So emotional agenda is by, you can look at the eyes of a person, you can look at the body language of a person, you can also listen to the tonality and the words of a person. And I also said that you also must develop the study of patterns. You know, I tell people that you need to study a few things. One, you want to study people. Be very careful to study people. Number two, you want to study power, because this world is filled with power. It's a power play. Number three, you want to study life. You want to develop a philosophy of life. And number four, you want to study patterns. And so when it comes to persuasion, you want to study things like people's language patterns. You want to be observant of people's language patterns. You also want to study and be observant of people's thought patterns, people's, in their conversations, you can find those patterns there. And that's how you can literally determine people's emotional agenda. And I said, in the only way to get people to speak, because when they speak, they leak. When they speak, they reveal their intention, their sentiment, is by asking well-crafted questions. So this is as I meant to you. From henceforth, start asking questions, not just to yourself, but to other people. In fact, start with yourself. Let me tell you one very interesting thing about questions. Questions fuel innovation and performance improvements? One of the questions I ask myself regularly is, how can I get better? What can I do to make myself better? Because you see, the goal is to be global. The goal is to benchmark with the best. The goal is to be the best they can be. So peak performance is achieved by the right kind of questions, especially personal questions. Questions that will help you start thinking. So what think question does is that questions forces you to think. It forces you personally to think. And beyond that, it also forces others to think. Now, as I'm speaking to you right now, and I'm very certain about this, you are probably drifting into trance, or your attention is not fully here, because statements, even if they are exclamations, don't fully grab attention. But if I were to ask a specific, thought-provoking, well-crafted and scripted questions to you, you will stop thinking and start thinking about what I am asking. You will stop thinking about whatever it is you were thinking prior and start thinking about what I'm asking, because questions arrest attention. Literally grabs you by the lapel and gets your attention. And so what you want to start doing to become a lot more influential, a lot more persuasive, is to start asking questions. A lot of people asking people questions. Now, if you're into public speaking and you hold on the podium and you're giving a message, one of the ways to do it, to get the people to do it, to get their attention, to snap them out of trance and bring them back into reality and bring them into attention, is to constantly fill your conversation, fill your message with questions. Whenever you saw innovation, a lot of questions were asked. Any great achievement is based on quality questions. And so the quality of your life is dependent on the questions that you ask yourself or you fail to ask yourself. So become an engaging person. Families, husbands or wives need to start asking the right questions. Quality questions, engaging conversation. And that is so interesting to note. So don't say, George, should I question? Become more deliberate and intentional about it. Become more consistent about asking questions. Let me just give you a few things about questions before we go into what kinds of questions we're talking about. All right. I said questions are used to grab attention as a speaker. I said your thoughts may drift, but there's questions snap you back into reality. Questions help you to poke the holes of a defrauder, of a fraudster. It helps you poke the holes of a storyteller. All right. Now, let me just say this about questions. Questions can help you rewire your brain. Now, I'm into life coaching, and I've been into life coaching for a number of years. People come to me, sit down, and I engage them in conversations. When I engage them in conversations, of course, you know that I will literally control the question. And in asking questions, I can use questions to break them out of hypnotic trance, self-limiting beliefs. I can destroy self-limiting beliefs by sending them thought-breaking, breaking questions that help them start rethinking. So I can rewire a person's brain, rewire literally a person's thinking, a person's system of thought, a person's pattern of thinking by asking questions. I can literally use questions to take them back to memory lane. When I'm dealing with people that have phobias and I feel in my spirit that the person has this issue from way back, his childhood, I can take him on a journey backwards and then ask him questions and then reframe him. Questions are a very fantastic way to get people to reframe people. So questions can also enable you to get rapport. How are you doing? How was your day? I hope you're good. Well done. So questions can be used to literally develop rapport. And the foundation of persuasion is rapport. The bedrock of persuasion is rapport. If you are speaking on stage, one of the fastest things to get rapport with the audience, because you see the audience really evaluating you. People will first see you before they hear you. They want to know how much content you truly have. And they are saying, why should I listen to this guy? What commonality do we share? Do we have a bond? So your job as a speaker is to find common ground, to find relatable ideas. And one of the ways to do that is to ask questions. You can poll the room. You can say, how are you guys doing? And so on and so forth. So questions literally can help you develop rapport. Questions, interestingly, can also put people into trance. Because I said there are a number of questions I can use to put people into trance. Does it make any sense at all to you? If you start asking good questions and nice questions, you can become more likable. According to Stanford University research, they said that questions make you a more likable person. People engage in conversation for two reasons. and engage in conversations, first of all, for information exchange, for learning, and they also engage information in questioning so that they can make a good impression. So use questions to unlock learning. If you meet a mentor, you know, you got to have the right questions to ask him, because you unlock his ideas and his wisdom, his treasure chest of wisdom, and he can give you all the kind of information you're looking for. All right, so now that said, let me go on now to talk about the different kinds of questions that we have, and then we'll call it a wrap for today. Different kinds of questions that you can start using, and we'll call it a wrap for today. The first question I want to talk about is called, pay attention now, it's called open-ended questions. Now, this will work very well if you're having one-on-one conversations with people. You're having a one-on-one conversation with a person, and you can also have an open-ended questions in a group meetings. And the idea, basically, open-ended questions are questions that get people to answer you, you know, to give you, tell you about themselves, to reveal. I already said that words advertise us. Words reveal our sentiments, our prejudice, our enthusiasm. Words gauge our knowledge. Words gives our knowledge, shows our fears. So in the words that we hear from people, when we ask questions, we can know a lot about them. So open-ended questions are questions that enable people to expose themselves. And that's what you want people to do. You want them to reveal their hot buttons. You want them to reveal their thought patterns. You want them to reveal their mind so that you can identify their emotional agenda and their anchors, and then literally use that as leverage to persuade them. So you use open-ended questions in conversations, in the sales process, even in a relationship you are trying to get together. You want to get that woman to be by your side. Then you want to build your marriage. Then you have to start asking a lot of open-ended questions. You also want to be involved in counseling. If you're a counselor, you need to learn how to ask open-ended questions. How are you? How, you know, why, when, who, what questions are very, very powerful questions, you know, that really gets people to open up. And that's what you want to do. So interestingly, we ask more questions than we speak. So that when we speak, we're speaking relevant knowledge. A lot of people talk. Talk is cheap. Talk is just babbling, saying everything that comes into your head, assuming, assumptions, lowest level of knowledge. But speaking is talking with a relevant message. Speaking is talking with answers. Speaking is talking with value. So when you want to speak to any audience or to an individual, then you want to start speaking with value. You want to start speaking with answers. Those answers will come from the questions that you previously asked, from the analysis of the audience, from the knowing of who the audience is. So open-ended questions are powerful questions. Another kind of question that you can ask are called closed-ended questions. What are closed-ended questions? Closed-ended questions are questions designed to get people to either say yes or no. And you use those kind of questions at the end of any kind of presentation or at the end of a sales presentation, when you want the person to say either yes or no, when you want the person to become more agreeable. If usually is associated with closed-ended questions. If aren't you, would you? Those kinds of conversations, the sentences that accompany if, aren't, wouldn't you, are questions that, you know, can get people to either say yes or no. When you get them to say yes or no, of course, you have literally persuaded them. So we have open-ended questions, we have closed-ended questions. Now, I'm going to be teaching people who join our training, our school for 5 months online, what mirror questions are. We have what mirror questions are, and I'm going to explain that to you. I'm not going to teach you here. I'm also going to be showing people who join our masterclass, who want me to teach them persuasion and public speaking, what full switch questions are, right? We also have what is called trigger questions. We have what is called follow-up questions. And I mean, these are powerful questions you can start using in your conversations, in your speeches, in your engagement, and become a lot more influential. There's also a kind of question called tag questions. Tag questions, let me just give you that as a freebie. Tag questions are questions that you add after a sentence or after a phrase. Tag questions are questions you ask after a sentence. For example, I tell you that you enjoyed this class, didn't you? You enjoyed this class. That's a sentence, right? Didn't you? That's the tag question. Any question that you ask after a statement of that nature is usually called a tag question. You follow me to church today, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you is a tag question. You're in love with me, aren't you? Aren't you is a tag question. We'll go places together, wouldn't we? Wouldn't we? Is a tag question. Start thinking of tag questions. And you see, people who are very persuasive use tag questions. Tag questions are usually get people to be agreeable. In fact, they don't give people the opportunity to answer or to, you know, they just get you to follow. So people who use tag questions get a whole lot of results. Notice that tag questions that are very powerful are associated with what is called embedded commands. What is an embedded command? And we have to be very careful, because you see, I study persuasion. I've studied for 15 years. And I've studied persuasion for so many years to know that the content of every word is either hypnotic, trance-inducing, or self-limiting, trance-inducing or trance-breaking. That's what I mean by that. So I study language patterns, I study words. And I've not said that tag questions are used by persuaders, used by negotiators, used by salespeople. And there's also what is called an embedded command. What's an embedded command? An embedded command is a statement of command that you infuse into a sentence without a person knowing that you're commanding him. Every time I go to school, I meet interesting people. You are one of them, aren't you? Let's break down that sentence. Every time I go to school, I meet interesting people. You are one of them, aren't you? You are one of them is the embedded command. I'm giving you a direct command that you are one of them. That embedded command has access to your subconscious. Okay, let me give you another one. We went to church yesterday. People's life will change. Parents' Day. People's lives will change. That is an embedded command. Or sometimes it can be an instructions. If I tell you a few things, you will come along with me, wouldn't you? You will come along with me. In that structure of sentence, that sentence, we have two things. We have an embedded command and we have a tag question. Embedded command, you may not know, is quite powerful. And so people who are into communication start studying language patterns, start studying Newton model, start studying precision model, start studying meta model, and the idea basically is to dissect these things and know how to speak. Now I'm sure you're wondering, wow, George, you're going quite complicated. I'm telling you, the world that we live in is filled with powerful men, and these powerful men know how to ask questions, know how to use embedded commands. I'm sure you got value today. So this is the assignment I want to give to you. Start thinking in terms of questions. Start becoming a lot more conscious of the questions that you're asking. Sometimes it can be very irritating when you ask too many questions, right? So you want to garnish questions with rapport tending statements. What I mean by that is that you want to be very tactful in your questioning. Not just too direct. Direct questions will put people off and make you not develop rapport, but you can become a lot more tactful, more subtle in your questioning, and you get people to, you know, to respond to you, to reveal real to you. You know, when people speak, when people start responding to you, you want to develop what we call sensory acuity and develop the ability to calibrate and measure whether they're telling the truth or not. When people speak, they delete certain things from their conversation. For example, you're talking to somebody and the person says, how are you doing, sir? The person says, I'm fine, no. That statement alone is impregnated with so many, many things. First of all, I'm fine, no. The tonality does not tell me that he's truly fine. In fact, the tonality tells me that he's probably not fine as he's mouthing or as he's verbalizing. I'm fine, no. Even in that statement, you can notice that he has deleted certain words. His true intention is in his mind, but his wordings have deleted certain statements. I'm fine, though. That statement is very ambiguous. And so what he has done, he has also done what's called generalization statement, because everybody's saying I'm fine, therefore I have to say I'm fine. And also that statement also has distorted the true state. Is distorting. Maybe there's a circumstance around him, a situation, a condition, and it's distorting. So he has generalized, he has distorted, and he has deleted. In just that simple statement, I'm fine. So as a person who is a persuader, I'm not just listening to his statement, I'm listening to the tonality of his statement, the tone. And I'm watching out for what he may have been deleting, what he may be generalizing, and what he may be distorting. Every time we speak, we are deleting, we are generalizing, we are distorting stuff. And so persuaders are listeners. I mean, you learn to listen and you listen to learn, and you get this valuable information. As you get the valuable information, you now are able to calibrate and use that information, you know, right now, you know, to gain leverage to help people. That's how to become an amazing person. That's what has changed my life. Persuasion, studying persuasion has changed my life, made me achieve the things I've achieved so far, and it's helping me to achieve so much more. And if you're going to make progress in your life, you want to study persuasion and you want to become a student of persuasion, and not just a persuasion of mass influence, public speaking. Persuasion, you can see persuasion in public speaking. In fact, public speaking has no bites without persuasion. That's why in our school, while we look at elocution and diction and grammar, our focus very often is on the persuasion element of public speaking, because that's what really public speaking is all about. Persuading people, getting people to follow your line of thought. Identifying people's emotional agenda and getting them to follow you. All right. To sway people by reframing them. You can persuade people by mirroring them. We looked at mirroring concept yesterday, and we'll still look at it in depth in the future. And get the person to follow your line of thinking. But of course, there are persuade people, and I've only shared two or so. And there are 9 more ways you can persuade anybody. If you know this knowledge, it will help you as a married person, help you as a teacher, person who works with difficult people. You need to study and know. Let me be your teacher for 5 months. If I teach you public speaking, amazing person. Nobody in Nigeria will teach you and public speaking with such depth and understanding. You know, I believe that is not just knowledge, it's a skill. What do I mean by skill? Skill, you know, it's a mastery, and it comes first from understanding, not just knowing. A lot of us have scattered, disjointed information, personnel, staff, leader, that you really need to be part of our training. I'm delighted to be with you, and I'm sure that you got some value. You wrote down some notes. Make efforts to share this. If you want and you're enjoying what you heard, I would really, really appreciate it if you can subscribe to our channel, and then also click on the notification button so that anytime we have new videos like this, we can also notify you. Make sure you subscribe, and then if you are on our Facebook group, Public Speaking Masterclass, share it, let people get to know about it. You want to become part of our training, our 5 months training online, where we show you through Zoom classes, WhatsApp training, and maybe sometimes Facebook Live classes like this, exclusive part of it. And we have a payment plan and a program that is very, very interesting. So you simply have to just reach out to me on 081-87-133-153. Again, 081-87-133-153. That's my phone number. Remember, you need to master persuasion on the quality of questions that you ask yourself or fail. I'll see you some other time. God bless you.